Do you want a politically incorrect gateway to a real history education? Then go to McClanahanAcademy.com. That's McClanahanAcademy.com.
Are you ready to think locally and act locally? Welcome to the Brion McClanahan Show.
Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. This is episode 131. Glad to have you back on the program. Glad to be here. Before we get started, all the usual stuff. If you like this podcast, please share it around on social media. And you can find me on social media on Facebook at Brion McClanahan, on Twitter at Brion McClanahan. And of course, you can subscribe to my YouTube page. Just go out and look for Brion McClanahan. If you don't want to search for all those things, go on out to my homepage, BrionMcClanahan.com. At the top of the page, you'll find all my social media buttons, and not just that, you can give me an email address there, and I'll give you a free ebook and a free audiobook, Forgotten Founders, with the audiobook read by yours truly. Also, I have my McClanahan Academy. Please go on out and find that, McClanahanAcademy.com. I've got two classes available at this point, Secession, An American Tale, and How Alexander Hamilton Screwed Up America, which covers my book of the same title, How Alexander Hamilton Screwed Up America. They are on sale right now. At the current moment, until the end of December, you can get the class, the Hamilton class, for half off. Just use the coupon code HALFHAMILTON at checkout, or you can get the Secession class for $5 off. Use the code 15SECESSION at checkout, and those will work till the end of December. So you can get a little bit of discount on each class, actually half a discount on the Hamilton class, but $5 off on the Secession class till the end of December. So go on out and check that out. In fact, the podcast today is going to focus on the sort of this topic of secession. So I'm going to give you kind of a precursor to that, whet your appetite, hopefully get you on out there and purchasing that secession class while it's still on sale. So the topic of today is a series of emails I received when I was on vacation, taking last week off, about the topic of secession. And it has to do with original intent. And so this was an email thread that I got involved in and a colleague sent and said, you know, how do I respond to this particular argument? And one of the arguments that was given, and I think this is an important distinction to make when we start talking about original intent, was about two statements that Madison and Washington had made. Also, there was an argument by John Jay and Alexander Hamilton. And so I'm going to focus on these nationalists and how that nationalist argument was, in fact, defeated at the during the ratification of the Constitution. But I do want to focus on a couple of the statements that were made, and they're taken out of context in this particular argument. So I think it's important to understand that. You have to put these quotes that were given in context of the entire piece. But essentially, this person was arguing that the usual stuff, and of course, I've gone over all of this in my Secession and American Tale class, these first, the first several arguments, namely that the Supremacy Clause says that all the laws made by the Constitution or by the general government are supreme. The states can't oppose those laws. Of course, the argument, the Article 1, Section 10 argument, that the states cannot enter into a confederation or treaty or alliance with each other. So I've gone in my Secession and American Tale class and refuted all of that stuff. But he does bring up, this particular argument does bring up the idea of original intent. So I want to talk about that because I think original intent is important. What was the original intent of the Constitution? What was the original intent of the founding generation when it came to this idea of disunion? Now, certainly, when you look at the Constitution itself, one of the reasons why the founding generation was considering a new governing document for the United States was because secession was openly threatened at times, and there was a fear of disunion. The Articles of Confederation, theoretically, and I think conclusively, made it to where there could be disunion. Now, you could argue somewhere in there that, as I've talked about, that somehow the Articles prevented secession, maybe even more fervently than the Constitution itself. But certainly, when you look at the Articles of Confederation, you look at Article 2 of the Articles of Confederation, the states retained all their sovereignty and independence, the sovereignty and independence that had been won through the American War for Independence. So this particular document would theoretically allow the states to leave that particular union. One state could block the entire process, and of course the entire union would then fall apart. But just because that was the case under the Articles doesn't mean that it remained the case under the Constitution, or you could also say that the Union didn't change. So I'm going to talk about these two arguments that were given, one from George Washington and one from James Madison. We're going to talk about original intent. First and foremost, though, we have to understand that the statements made by the founding generation at the ratification conventions and in the several documents that were selling the Constitution to the states during the ratification process provide original intent. This is what is meant by original intent. You have to go back and look at these things to understand what the Constitution meant, not just the Philadelphia Convention itself, but also all of these ratification documents and debates. And so one of the responses to this particular argument was that, well, those things don't mean anything because it's just the opinion of somebody. But those things do mean something. So you do have to deal with them. You have to wrestle with what John Jay, for example, was saying, or George Washington, or Hamilton, or Madison. But there is a tremendous amount of evidence that shows that these nationalist arguments that were made are entirely on the losing side. If they were being made from a nationalist perspective, and I can actually point out saying, well, that's not necessarily true at all, that what the arguments that this particular person is using don't prove anything except the fact that the states were still the parties of this particular document, at least in a particular fashion. And of course, Article 7 of the Constitution, I think, conclusively proves that the states were still parties to the compact, and that this was still an agreement between the states, so ratifying the same, as Article 7 says. But the way it was ratified was slightly different, as Madison gets into in one of these arguments, and so I'm going to get into that. But original intent is important. And to find original intent, you have to go back and look at the ratification debates and the several documents that were issued during the time period when the Constitution was going through ratification. You can find these. Of course, there is a wonderful series on this. And it's a multi-volume series, in excess of 40 volumes now. The Documentary History of the Ratification of the Constitution, published by the Wisconsin Historical Society. And, of course, there's several volumes dedicated to states, whether it's Virginia, New York, Massachusetts. They have large collections. But there's also volumes dedicated to Pennsylvania, where the documents are pretty sparse, but Connecticut, they're working on North Carolina and other states. So, and then there's the General Commentaries, which are, in fact, my favorite volumes. The General Commentaries, there are five volumes of that, and in these commentaries you find all of the public documents that are related to the ratification of the Constitution. What I mean by public documents, not the speeches and the ratifying conventions, but things like the Federalist Essays, the quote-unquote anti-Federalist Papers. You find it all in these volumes on the commentaries. And there's five volumes of those, so it's a nice collection of these volumes. And so when you look at this, and of course you can use Eliot's debates at the Philadelphia Convention, when you look at these particular documents, you can glean an original position. This is what my Founding Fathers' Guide to the Constitution is all about. It's a singular one-volume book on original intent. That was the whole point of the book, to condense all this stuff down and give you, as concisely as I could, what original intent was when it in various clauses of the Constitution. So let's focus on these two documents that this person says conclusively prove that secession was not considered to be valid by the founding generation. So I'll read this particular argument. I'm going to read all of these things. And again, I've gone over much of this stuff in my Secession and American Tale class, which you can get for $25 right now till the end of December. Go on out there and get that, McClanahanAcademy.com. So he says, look, it's secession constitutional. Let's see. The Constitution, Article 1, Section 10, no state shall enter into any treaty, alliance, or confederation So I've already gone over this in the secession course. The Supremacy Clause, I've already gone over that. And then he says, Alexander Hamilton said in Federalist 9 and 11 that the states were bound together in a strict and indissoluble union. And this was further proved by the Militia Act of 1792, the Force Bill of 1833, and in a letter that James Madison wrote to Alexander Hamilton saying, the Constitution requires ratification in toto and forever. Anything less for only a limited time would be as defective as if partial adoption. So he's saying that this proves that Madison is saying, well, there's no out once you ratify. This is in toto and forever. There's no out clause in the document. He also says Article 4, Section 3, in the admittance of states, Congress can admit states, and therefore only the Congress can allow states to secede, because they're the ones that admit the states. He also says the preamble proves that the people ratified the document, not the states. And then he gives a couple of documents, Madison and Federalist 43. This is one I'm going to talk about, where he says the express authority of the people alone could give the Constitution validity. To require full ratification by the states would have marked a want of foresight. Now, this is he's taking some things out of context here. And he also says George Washington's letter to the states says it is obviously impracticable to provide independent sovereignty to the states and yet provide safety for all. Again, taken out of context. He also mentions John Jay in Federalist 4. To all purposes, we have been one people. As a nation, we have made peace. As a nation, made war. So he says that it's the people who ratified, not the states, and the above, quote-unquote, proves it. Does it, though? Do these statements prove anything? Now, as far as the Militia Act, I've already covered that, again, in this particular podcast. I went over the Militia Act and what that actually meant and how that particular law was, in fact, unconstitutional. Because when you look at how that law is structured, it ignores another part of the Constitution that requires the general government to have the authority of the state legislatures or the governor itself to send in the military to enforce the laws, essentially, if there is a state of rebellion. So that proves nothing, that secession was somehow illegal. And, of course, he also states the Force Bill, where he says Congress said that secession was illegal. But, again, you're missing something here. There are many people in the founding generation, as I document in my secession course, that believe that secession was perfectly legal and justifiable, even into the 1830s when he's talking about the Force Bill, even when the Militia Act was written in 1792. But I want to focus again on this part where he brings up Washington and Madison. Now, Hamilton aside, because I've already tackled Hamilton in an entire book, so I'm not going to discuss Hamilton. I talk about the duplicitous Hamilton quite a bit in the book and how he says one thing and then does another, and so Hamilton lies quite a bit. I do believe that Hamilton probably thought that there was no right of secession. But that was Hamilton's opinion, and it was the minority opinion. So let's look at this Washington quote. And this comes from a letter of the president of the Federal Convention dated September 17, 1787, to the president of Congress. So what happened is Washington wrote this letter when the Constitution was agreed to on September 17th, sent it to the Congress. Of course, the Congress of the United States, sitting at that point. And I will read to you the part where I'll just read you the whole letter because I think it's a very short letter. I'll omit a couple of lines, but it's a very short letter. So he says, quote, "The friends of our country have long seen and desired that the power of making war, peace, and treaties, that of levying money and regulating commerce, and the correspondent executive and judicial authority should be fully and effectively vested in the general government of the Union. But the impropriety of delegating such extensive trust to one body of men is evident. Hence results the necessity of a different organization." So he's already laying out what the general government should be able to do. Make war, peace, and treaties, levy money, and regulate commerce. And then, of course, having an executive and judicial branch. He continues, quote, "It is obviously impracticable in the federal government of these states to secure all rights of independent sovereignty to each and yet provide for the interests and safety of all." So let me get into this. To secure all rights of independent sovereignty to each. So go back and let me read what this individual says. "It's obviously impractical to provide independent sovereignty to the states." This is not what it says. Washington says, "It is obviously impractical in the federal government of these states to secure all rights of independent sovereignty to each, and yet provide for the interests and safety of all." So he's not even quoting the line correctly. All rights of independent sovereignty. Now remember, when Jefferson wrote the Declaration, he said that these free and independent states now have all the powers which free and independent states may of right have, which included the power to make war, conclude peace, contract alliances, do all the things that independent states may of right ought to do. So he's saying, well, you can't have all of that. He outlines in the first sentence, what are the things that the general government is going to do? The states can't do those things independently. And then he continues, "Individuals entering into society must give up a share of liberty to preserve the rest. The magnitude of the sacrifice must depend as well on situation and circumstance as on the object to be obtained. It is at times difficult to draw with precision the line between those rights which must be surrendered and those which may be reserved. And on the present occasion, this difficulty was increased by a difference among the several states as to their situation, extent, habits, and particular interests." So, he's saying, look, when you enter society, you have to give up some rights to secure the liberty of the rest. And so what he's saying is the states have to give up something. War, peace, treaties, not even levying money, because, of course, it was argued the states could still do this, and regulating commerce between the states. Those are the things they have to grant to the central authority, essentially giving up, if you look at Article 1, Section 10, the ability to do that independently. However, once you are sovereign, it does not mean that you grant these things forever and they cannot be rescinded. I've talked about that in this podcast, in the episode, I Grant You the Power. So Washington continues, "In all our deliberations on this subject, we kept steadily in our view that which appears to us the greatest interest of every true American, the consolidation of our union, in which is involved our prosperity, felicity, safety, perhaps our national existence. The important considerations seriously and deeply impressed on our minds led each state in the convention to be less rigid on points of inferior magnitude than might have been otherwise expected. And thus the Constitution, which we now present, is the result of a spirit of amity, and of that mutual deference and concession which the peculiarity of our political situation rendered indispensable. That it will meet the full and entire approbation of every state is not perhaps to be expected, but each will doubtless consider that had her interest been alone consulted, the consequences might have been particularly disagreeable or injurious to others. That it is liable to as few exceptions as could reasonably have been expected, we hope and believe, that it may promote the lasting welfare of that country so dear to us all and secure her freedom and happiness is our most ardent wish." So let's get into what Washington said here. So he's saying, look, we have a consolidation of the Union. As the preamble says, it's a more perfect union. Is it a consolidated nation is the question. Of course, that particular point was argued over and over and over again in the ratifying debates. And the consensus came out of that is that, no, we don't have a consolidated nation. What we have is a federation. There's no difference between a federation and a confederation. In fact, the selling point for the Constitution was the Senate of the United States, because the Senate was seen as the vehicle for the states to resist the general government. Because the Senate has complete control of the executive branch in many ways, and the judicial branch, and the legislative branch. So that is the voice of the states. It is the federal part of the document itself. And so as Ellsworth and Wolcott of Connecticut made clear in the Connecticut Ratifying Convention, well, I mean, the states can just withhold their senators if they don't want this government to do anything. You just don't send your senators, because the legislatures were choosing the senators. And if you do that, there's no quorum. Nothing can get done. The president can't do anything. The judicial branch can't do anything because there won't be any judges, in essence. And so you can block the entire process. The House can't do anything because the Senate is not there to concur. So what he's saying here is that the states were less rigid on points of inferior magnitude. Less rigid. But, of course, when you go back and read those debates, people like John Rutledge of South Carolina saying if the general government had a negative over state law, that alone would damn the convention, the Constitution, we would never get it. And, of course, there is no federal negative over state law. If you go back and look at the state constitutions, and this is kind of a warm-up for another course that I'm working on for McClanahan Academy. When you go back and look at those constitutions and you see how vague they are, that was because, as James Wilson said in the period during ratification, in fact, the State House Yard speech was what everyone based their arguments on for months about the Constitution, that, look, the states have unlimited and undefined powers. The general government has limited and defined powers. If we don't say you can do it, you can't do it. The states can do everything else. And, of course, if it doesn't say a state cannot secede, then a state can secede. I mean, that's very clear about an implied power of the states. But the states are surrendering certain parts of their authority to the general government. They're granting those powers. But a granted power can be rescinded. We can just rescind that grant. And therefore, we have those powers ourselves. So you could argue, you know, how this would work. Can an individual state do that? Does it have to be a collection of states? Whatever. We can argue that point. But certainly, as the people of the states ratified the document, therefore the people of the states can destroy the document as well. And not just that, the people of the states can decide if they're going to be a part of this compact or not. And as Virginia made clear, they wanted a resumption clause. So did New York. Same thing. So Washington's letter proves nothing, except that the general government gets certain delegated powers and it cannot go beyond those delegated powers, and that the states are entering into this union, what he calls a consolidated union, much more consolidated union, which, I mean, it's hard to argue that the Constitution didn't create a stronger union in terms of giving the general government more power. But it still was a union of what? A union of states. And so as a union of states, nothing has really changed. All right, so let's get to the Madison argument. Let's go to this line of Federalist 43. And so you go all the way down to point 9. Point 9 says, quote, "The ratification of the conventions of 9 states shall be sufficient for the establishment of this Constitution between the states so ratifying the same." So Madison continues, "This article speaks for itself. The express authority of the people alone could give due validity to the Constitution. To have required the unanimous ratification of the 13 states would have subjected the essential interests of the whole to the caprice or corruption of a single member. It would have marked a want of foresight in the convention, which our own experience would have rendered inexcusable. Two questions of a very delicate nature present themselves on this occasion. Number one, on what principle in the Confederation, which stands in the solemn form of a compact among the states, can be superseded without the unanimous consent of the parties to it? Number two, what relation is to subsist between the 9 or more states ratifying the Constitution, the remaining few who do not become parties to it? The first question is answered at once by recurring to the absolute necessity of the case, to the great principle of self-preservation, to the transient law of nature and of nature's God, which declares that the safety and happiness of society are the objects at which all political institutions aim, and to which all such institutions must be sacrificed." So let's dive into this for a second. This doesn't really prove anything that secession was somehow illegal. Because he says, look, the people alone could give due validity to the Constitution. The people alone. The people of what? The people of the states. And he gets into that when he answers the first part. He says, "Perhaps also an answer may be found without searching beyond the principles of the compact itself. It has been heretofore noted among the defects of the Confederation that in many of the states it had received no higher sanction than a mere legislative ratification. So here's where he's getting into the people. What he's saying is the conventions, which are the voice of the people, have to ratify the Constitution, not the legislatures of the states. And this is clear. So he's not saying that the states are not parties to this agreement. It's clearly said so in Article 7. It clearly says so. But he's saying this is not done through the legislatures of the states, but through the people of the states. He says, a compact between independent sovereigns founded on ordinary acts of legislative authority can pretend to no higher validity than a league or treaty between the parties. It is established doctrine on the subject of treaties that all the articles are mutually conditions of each other, that a breach of any one article is a breach of the whole treaty, and that a breach committed by either of the parties absolves the others and authorizes them, if they please, to pronounce the compact violated and void. Should it unhappily be necessary to appeal to these delicate truths for a justification for dispensing with the consent of particular states to a dissolution of the federal pact, will not the complaining parties find it a difficult task to answer the multiplied and important infractions with which they may be confronted? So he's saying, in some ways, that this particular act of the Constitution is destroying the Articles of Confederation. Essentially, what he's doing here is saying there is a secession taking place now of these states from under the Articles to the Constitution. But it's being ratified by the people, not the legislatures. Now, what's interesting about this is he gets into the fact that if there's a breach of the compact, what happens? If there's simple compact, well, then the states, obviously, can say we're out. The fact is, though, that we still had a compact. As Madison himself pointed out in 1798, we still had a compact. This Constitution still was a compact between the states, as it says in Article 7. It's just that the people now ratified it, not simple legislative action. And so when you look at what happened in, say, 1860 and 61 with the southern states, they left the Union through a convention. They didn't just do it through the legislature. They didn't just go out and say, all right, legislative act, we're out. No, they called a convention, and that convention said, we're out of the Union. So the people spoke again and said, we're no longer part of this particular compact. And so here you have this section again proving nothing. It proves nothing. Madison is not proving anything here that secession is somehow illegal at all. Again, taken out of context, it seems like Madison is saying, yeah, well, you can't get rid of the, you can't secede. So these arguments are passed around quite a bit. Well, here it is, conclusive proof. These people right here said it, so therefore secession was illegal. I don't think Madison thought that at all. I don't think Jefferson thought that at all. I don't think anyone in the founding generation thought that at all. I think the evidence is clearly on the side that no, they did not think that. They thought secession was perfectly legal and justifiable at times. Now, they could call it the right of revolution, but certainly they thought that the Union was not indissoluble. Now, Hamilton may have believed that, and I think there were some members of the founding generation that believed that. But for the most part, you would find, and if you look at the acts of the founding generation, what they said after the Constitution was ratified, I think most of them believed, the majority believed, that the Constitution was not permanent in that a state could not leave if they chose to do so. So I wanted to get into this because, again, original intent is important. And so you have these arguments. But taken out of context, it seems like, well, I mean, certainly original intent is against secession, against the idea that the states are still sovereign. That's not the case at all. But that argument still persists, unfortunately. And so it's important to get into this and, of course, explain how this particular individual in writing these things is completely incorrect. But again, you would know this if you took my course on secession, and if you want to get the discount for it, I'm giving it to you. It's a coupon, a checkout, 15 secession. You get it for $5 off, and that will give you the course for $25. Now until the end of December, you've only got about a month left to get that discount, and then there will be no longer a discount. And of course, you can get my Hamilton class for half off. Just use the coupon code HALFHAMILTON. You get it for $36 rather than $72. And so if you've got my book, you might want to get that course as well. And not just that, if you do have my book, please leave a review on Amazon. And also, if you like this podcast, please leave a review on iTunes. I didn't mention that at the beginning. Hope you enjoyed this episode of the Brion McClanahan Show. I'll see you next time.